So I'd like to introduce myself to begin with. My name is Hamza Umar, and I'm one of the fourth year medical students at the University of Birmingham. And ISB have kindly asked me to share this event that they're holding today. So before I begin, I would like to give a massive thank you to ISB for facilitating this amazing event. We have three amazing speakers for you guys here today, and they're going to be giving an insight onto the facts regarding the COVID vaccine from an Islamic point of view and from a public health point of view. So first, I'm going to introduce the three speakers, and I'm going to hand over to Dr. Munna. So the first speaker that we have is Dr. Munna Abdel Aziz, and she is the director of public health of Salford, and she is also the chair of Your B Credit Union, which is the UK's first compliant loans company. And then following on from that, we have a doctor and a scholar known as Shaykh Rafaqat, and he has done massive work in the community, and he's a co-founder and the director of the Al-Balagh Academy, and he's the director of one of the most popular courses on medical fiqh. So if you want to look into that, please do drop us an email or message in the chat, and we can direct you to the right person for that. And finally, we have Nurdad Aziz, and he's the district councillor of Hindburn Borough, and he's also a chartered accountant by profession. So before I hand over to Munna, I've been allocated some time to talk about coronavirus. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to talk about some of the facts regarding coronavirus and some of the myths surrounding the vaccination. So I'm not going to go into too much detail about the facts about coronavirus, because it's been well documented in the media. So we know that it's spread via person-to-person contact, and that's via aerosol droplets, and it can be spread via direct contact. And there are two phases of the disease progression. So you have the preclinical phase, or the pre-symptomatic phase, and that occurs for roughly 3 days, and the patient is not symptomatic at this point. And then you have the clinical phase, where the patient is expressing some clinical symptoms, and roughly 81% have mild to moderate symptoms, and 5% have critical symptoms. We also recently have found out that if you are from Black or ethnic minority origin, you are 3 times more likely to contract coronavirus, and you are 5 times more likely to have adverse outcomes. So that is when you're on ICU or being admitted into hospital. And I've been given a portion to talk about some of the myths surrounding coronavirus or the vaccination. But I'm not going to go into too much detail about that, because I think our speakers are kindly going to explain all of those away. But these are some of the myths that I've come across recently, and some of them are, you know, absurd to say the least. And they can be quite, they are people's opinions, but I'm going to go through them. So one of them that is quite important is the belief that the vaccine is haram. And this is something that is going to be talked about in this lecture. And another one that I've come across, another myth surrounding the COVID vaccine, is that it contains a tracking device. So the government want to track people's location. And this is something else that we're going to be explaining away. And also some people believe that the vaccination causes fertility issues. And I can understand that that's a major concern for some people, and it might be a deterrent for taking the vaccination. And finally, there was another one that I came across, is that the vaccination contains aborted fetal cells and specimens derived from pig. And as a consequence, the vaccination would be haram in some people's from some people's perspective. So now that my portion is done, I'd like to hand over to Dr. Munna.
So bismillah. So we're going to talk about the COVID vaccines, and then I'm going to explain what I mean by going east. So I'm going to give just a little bit about information about the coronavirus, what we know about it so far, where, how, and why it spreads, and why we see the vaccines being so important as the light at the end of a tunnel. but also going to look at Black Lives Matter and what you can do about that. So now we do know quite a lot about the virus. I mean, this is an artist's depiction. It shows the way it has the spikes on it. That's where it gets its name, the coronavirus. And it's covered by a lipid layer, which you can wash off very easily with soap and water. And that's why hand hygiene has always been the most important infection control even before we get to know that there are bacteria or that there are viruses, washing hands has been used for infection control. And there are lots of tests now that can detect bits and portions of this virus. It can find the nucleic acids, which is the coils in the middle of the virus, which give the virus its identity. And also there are tests that pick up the protein spikes, that those red bits that are spiking out of its coat. And so we can test for that antigen, and we have some rapid tests that have recently been rolled out. Also, we can have some tests for the antibodies, and we know that antibodies are developed when you start to fight off the virus, and that's what the vaccine is trying to do, is trying to provoke an immune response in the person so that they recognize the virus when it comes in for real. So it really is easy now that we know so much about the virus, and it really is easy to know how do we stop the virus. And all the messaging that we've had so far has been about hands, make sure your hands are clean, whether with soap and water, which is the best, or with an alcohol rub. Face, make sure you wear face coverings out in public because that protects yourself, it protects other people. And space, make sure that you're at least 2 meters away from people you don't live with. And if you are within 2 meters or 1 meter, there's a higher risk that you can catch this virus, especially the newer viruses. So the virus keeps changing its coat, changes some of the buttons on its coat, but still the same virus. And it's trying to really survive with all of us fighting the virus off. And one of the ways in which it can survive is, for example, it becomes a little bit more sticky. So the minute you have you've been exposed to the virus, it tends to cling onto your cells and try to actually get in. And that's why it's more transmissible, these new variants are. And then we've looked at the virus across the UK, and we've seen it sort of the first wave and then a second wave. And now we're in the middle of a third wave. Hopefully we're coming out of that. But different populations and groups have experienced the outbreak at different times. So the first wave hit mostly the older people, particularly those in care homes. We weren't testing in the community at the time, but in the second wave, when we were testing, we saw a huge number of cases out in the community, people who were well and some people who didn't even realize they were carrying the virus. And now we're in the third wave. So you can see that the top chart over there shows the pattern for England, but the bottom chart is more patchy, where you have some different communities being affected at different points in time. And the chart below I've given from our own area in Salford, where, for example, after the older people, it went straight into our BAME communities and one Black or Asian minority ethnic communities. And one of our concerns is where the virus went in first, it'll be the last to leave. And that's why we're really, really concerned about our communities. And then it's really attractive to consider that vaccines are preserving life and making history, to know that actually clean water, sanitation and vaccination have been the reason for our civilizations to progress across the world. And we've got a range of vaccines that have been developed over time, starting with the smallpox vaccine, which is now, you know, it's been eradicated, and then some that we're still fighting, like the polio virus. And then ones like the influenza virus, where you have to develop a new vaccine every year because the influenza virus keeps changing its coat and keeps changing bits of its RNA. And for coronavirus, then we know vaccines do save lives and vaccines do stop the spread of disease. But when you have a pandemic like influenza in 1918 or like the 2019 coronavirus, actually, it's almost like you have a pandemic once every the start of a century. But we've had some smaller pandemics in the meantime, but they haven't been as brutal, they haven't been as, you know, fatal as we are now seeing with coronavirus. So these pandemics happen because a new virus turns up that none of us had been exposed to. All of us are equally susceptible to, and all of us are vulnerable. But with all these viruses, they affect people, some people, they affect them the most. And that's because they've been exposed to it, like our NHS and health and care workers, or because they're vulnerable in themselves, they've got a health condition, or they continue to smoke, they have high blood pressure, and they're from a BAME community, Black and Asian minority ethnic groups. And so those people will have the more severe effects. But we are making history, and it's very attractive to think of the vaccines in this way. So the COVID vaccines, well, there are now quite a few. So there are five that are making their way through in the UK, three that are being rolled out. So the Pfizer vaccine came out first. It needs to be kept under minus 70 degrees, intense cold. So you can see how the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, which is similar to the Pfizer, they won't be able to get to the reaches of Asia and Africa where it's really, really hot. So the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, when it came out, I think that was the one which all of us across the world were really, really pleased to know, because for one thing, it's affordable. And the other, of course, it can be kept in a fridge. So it can be sort of distributed along the same ways that we've been distributing the polio virus, the polio vaccine. So anywhere and everywhere across Africa, Asia, Europe, and the Americas. And then we know that these COVID vaccines are safe and effective. And Hamza started to explain some of the myths that people are kind of like feeling a little bit suspicious. But I just wanted to reassure you that vaccine development is a very, very long history. It's an industry that is really safe and effective and is regulated the way your usual medicines are regulated and tested. So we all got used to having paracetamol, or Panadol, as some of us call it, with, in terms of its trade name. But these medicines, they all have side effects, but we just seem to hang on to something new and think view it with more suspicion. But actually, all these medicines, our insulins, our paracetamols, all of our medicines, all of our devices, all of the vaccines have been through a lot of testing. They've been through clinical trials. They're really, really well regulated, and we're monitoring their side effects. So the reason the COVID vaccines came out so quickly is because the whole world stopped. All the scientists and governments have been funding and working on COVID-19 because of its impact on the world. There's been no shortage of money. And actually, there's been no shortage of volunteers, because everyone is vulnerable. It means that you don't have to wait for the next case of polio to develop before you say, well, the polio vaccine was safe and effective. With COVID, cases were happening in the thousands every day, and there was no shortage of volunteers to test them. And luckily, these trials took place at the same time alongside the manufacturers who were getting ready to actually produce this at scale. And they have been looked at, and they're continuously being monitored. And here in the UK, we have, of course, these three vaccines that have been approved. So it's still talking about the vaccines as being really attractive. They're the light at the end of the tunnel. And some of the questions that we've been asked, well, how does it work? It works by sending a message for your cells. So the vaccines are actually just messages. They go into your cells just for a few hours, and it asks your cells to create a protein, a bit of a protein that looks like the spike on the virus. So it's that virus spike protein. So it's actually not the virus itself, it's just one button on the coat of the virus that the vaccine asks your cells to produce. And then your cells remember, oh, this is strange, this isn't a human protein, let's knock it, and the antibodies start working. So the vaccine is cleared from your body straight away within hours, but your body remembers the spike protein, and your body will fight it off once the real virus tries and come attacking. So we're also asked, is there a difference to the way men and women react to the vaccine? No, there's no difference. Actually, women of childbearing age can take the vaccine and they can continue to plan their pregnancy. The thing is, we don't normally vaccinate pregnant women unless it's much more harmful for them. So if they work in health and care, or if they've got a health condition like heart disease and they're pregnant, we say, well, okay, we'll have to vaccinate you definitely. And young children, can they be vaccinated in the same way that we're giving them the polio, the measles, the tetanus vaccines? Well, young people who are over the age of 16 and they have a health condition, they'll be vaccinated first. And right now there are trials that are undertaken for younger children using the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine to see if we can protect young children as well, particularly people who have a disability or have a health condition and they are younger than the age of 16. So that's coming. And children will start to be vaccinated from the end of February. So their turn has come, even though, of course, we know that they don't get the severe consequences of the virus as much as older people do. So the question, can you get COVID from the vaccine? Oh, no, you can't. There are no live components in the vaccine. You just get some mild side effects that kind of like feel like the virus, but aren't really the virus. And it's a good sign that if your body mounts a sort of an immune response and you start to feel shivery and hot and, you know, hot and cold, and you start to feel a bit of a tickle in your throat from the vaccine, well, that's a good thing. It shows that your body is fighting the vaccine, and so you'll be able to fight the virus next time round. Another question is, how can we know the long-term side effects? Well, we're using technology that's been used for vaccines all along, and we know the long-term side effects from vaccines. So why should this one be any different? The scientists haven't skipped any steps in the process. Millions of people have been vaccinated already, and we are continuing to monitor the impact of the vaccine. So I wanted to talk about how we care about each other and how we care about our communities, and you care about yourself and your loved ones. Well, so do we. 1 in 5 adults in the UK have received their first dose. More than 10 million people in England have been vaccinated. And of the older people, 9 out of 10 people who are older than 75 years of age have been protected. Now I ask, well, who's the 10th person and why haven't they been protected? That's my question to you. You care about yourself and your loved ones, well, so do I. We must make sure that the 10th person who's over the age of 75 gets vaccinated. And we must make sure that of the thousands of frontline staff that haven't yet been vaccinated should also go for that vaccine. And the other way that we can stop the spread, of course, is by following all the rules, get a test, stay at home if you feel unwell, and stay at home until the restrictions can be lifted. I just wanted to point out why lives matter, why Black lives matter, all our lives matter. We're lucky to live in a country where the vaccine has come in, so we shouldn't delay. When we asked recently in December and January, the Office of National Statistics asked about who would take up the vaccine when it's offered. Well, 85% of people said they'd go for it. But sadly, 49% of people from a Black heritage said they'd go for it. Where's the other 51%? Why aren't they going for it? They're the 10th person in of those older people. They should be going to take it as well. 69% overall from all the Black, Asian, and other ethnic groups as well. So you can see immediately that people who need the vaccine are the least likely to take it up. And why are they worried? Why are they concerned? Some people said, well, they prefer to wait. Now, I'm going to tell you why it's not a good idea to wait. We've got the vaccine already now, and if it comes to you, you should put your arm out, as I will to myself. There are countries across the world who get the vaccine late, and some that are supported by the WHO. They are the COVAX countries. The World Health Organization will support them to get the vaccine. Well, they won't get vaccinated before 2024. And with this vaccine and with this virus, if it's a virus that changes every year, like the influenza virus, then people in some of the most developed countries will be vaccinated 3 times before someone in Africa and Asia. So really don't delay. There's already an inequality here, but you have to protect yourself and your community so we can bring back life as it potentially needs to go forward as a new normal. And it has to be timely before it's too late. Why delay if you can protect yourself? So how can you protect yourself? All the sensible precautions, hands, face, space, but you should also understand the risk. You should know how high your risk is. So for example, if you work in a frontline health and care role, or if you work in somewhere where you meet lots of people in the public, for example, taxi drivers, security guards, well, most of them and many of them are from a Black and ethnic minority group, and they are exposed more than the general public. But also you should consider your risk if you're older. So someone from a minority group who's aged 60 years old will have the age of COVID risk of someone who's 65 year old and isn't ethnic minority. But if they have a health condition and they're 45 years old, then they'd be equal risk to someone who's a white but 65 years old. So you already see a 20 years difference between the BAME group, Black and ethnic minority group, and white counterparts. So remember, every small change we make can have a huge difference. Reduce your exposure and reduce the impact. So stay at home if you're unwell, make sure you're tested if you're unwell, and make sure you're vaccinated if the vaccine is offered to you. So remember, the vaccine is offered to people who are most likely to benefit and most likely to be able to protect. So take it up as quickly as possible. Otherwise, it may be too late when someone re-invites you or remembers we're doing a mop-up. And vaccinating frontline workers will protect everyone. vaccinating people with health conditions will protect everyone. So remember to use your voice and actually take up the vaccine when it is offered. Make sure that your loved ones are taking up the vaccine when it is offered, particularly our elders. So why are we going east?
Dr. Munna.
So why are we going east? We know that so much already about the virus and the vaccines.
Dr. Munna. I'm going to have to stop you there because I think it's Shaykh Rafaqat's time.
Yes, so I'll stop sharing now. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that.
Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. نحمد ونصلي على رسول الكريم أما بعد سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and thank you for inviting me to this seminar or this session on COVID vaccines. Now I'm going to be sort of straight to the point. Inshallah, hopefully I'll finish in my time. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to briefly outline what I'm going to talk about from that perspective. So there are a couple of things I will be referring to, inshallah, in this short sort of talk. One is I'll be mainly referring to issues related to obligations in seeking treatment. So this is very important. What are the obligations from the Sharia perspective for Muslims to seek treatment? Are they obligations in terms of they are mandatory? Is it just something which is permissible just on that basis? Then we'll talk a bit about everything which is permissible by default. This is a theological position. The majority of the scholars in Islamic history and so forth, and even contemporary times, have accepted and agreed upon. Then there's something about the use of preventative therapy. What does Islam say about preventative therapy? And then we'll talk about the issue of purification, tadawi bil muharram, medication that contains impure ingredients. And then I will make reference to the three principles approach to fake news. How should we take on news and whether we should pass this on from our WhatsApp group to others so that they learn from this information, especially if that information is something which is considered as not authentic. And then finally, we'll finish off on the issue of asbab. Now, let me first begin with the first issue, and that is regarding the obligation to seek treatment. So all the madhahib, all the schools of Sunni thought basically agree that it is at least permissible, mubah, for you to take treatment. Now, on this basis, you'll find that there is one or two differences that exist, especially within the Hanbali school, where they say that there is a few scholars there that say that abstention is better, but that is pivotal on the condition that somebody has a high level of taqwa. And in full honesty, in a practical perspective, in the terms of the effectiveness of drugs and treatments as we are today, we don't really have the level of sabr to be able to maintain and control pain and manage pain without any form of treatment or pain relief. And it really is a big test. For that reason, even the Hanbali scholars will agree that it would be considered as permissible to take medication. No one actually disagrees that it's not permissible to take medication and that we should rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is a very important point. It's a theological position that needs to be clearly identified. Now, the other thing that's important for us to understand is that we have a senses of levels of certainty when it comes to fiqh. So this is Islamic law. In Islamic law, there are certain things that we will accept. Now, what kind of things are allowed and permitted to come into the discourse related to matters of fiqh, of permissibility, of halal and haram? And those are things what we call these different maratib, these different levels of certainty. Now, if you look at this slide very quickly, you'll see we cannot reach yaqeen when it comes to medication. The only time we can achieve yaqeen is that we know for sure that somebody will die if they do not eat, because eating food is clearly the essential part of our living, that if we don't eat, we will die. So this is a sense of yaqeen. We have yaqeen here. But majority of the kind of medication that we would consider as being effective would actually fall on the scope of what we call ghalabat al-zan. Okay, this is predominant or dominant probability. So this reaches around about 75% effectiveness. Other than that, it will be considered as madhnoon, and this will be considered as something which is presumptive, which is around 50% and higher. So when we talk about vaccines and their permissibility and drugs and their permissibility, we need to bring in evidence which at least achieves a level of ghalabat al-zan on the basis, by default, recognizing that medication is permissible, unless there is evidence to suggest the contrary. That's the first point. And the second point, which is I'm going to just provide some evidence to suggest that. The second point is that we need to also be clear that when it comes to somebody bringing in hujjah, proof, that this vaccine or this medication is haram, they need to provide evidence at the level of at least dominant probability. 75%, 80% authentic evidence for us to now accept that as a strong enough stringent condition for us to now say that this particular drug or vaccine is harmful. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. So here we have what we call the default position of permissibility. So everything is considered as halal unless there is hujjah, there is proof to suggest that it is haram. So on this perspective, all things are halal to utilize. So the ulama use the verse of the Quran, huwallazi khalaqa lakum ma fil ardi jami'a. He is the one who has created for you everything that is in the earth. In other words, everything by default is halal until there is evidence or the Sharia will stipulate from the Quran and Sunnah that it is haram. Okay, and this has to be of a certainty level, which I already explained. So what this is what most Muslims are in agreement with, and this is what we will follow in our sort of a Islamic traditional approach. Now, use of preventative therapy. Now, this is an interesting topic. The question is, this is actually a science in itself. We used to call it, in other words, it's called tib al-wiqai. Tib al-wiqai refers to that sense of medicine which is preventative. So we have tib al-ilaji. Tib al-ilaji is a treatment that is given for cure. So if somebody's ill, you treat them, you give them medicine, and that is called tib al-ilaji. Where tib al-wiqai is preventative medicine. Preventative medicine exists in many different formats. There are many chapters of kitabs in fiqh and also in hadith, which stipulate, for example, issues of tahara. So don't consume dead meat because there is harm in this. So this is preventative. So we'll give many examples of this as we go along. So the first thing to recognize here is the first thing, seeking that which benefits and that which reduces or ceases harm is something that is encouraged. So you see here, there is a hadith of Sahih Muslim, which says the strong believer is better and more beloved to Allah than the weak Muslim. And all that is good, seek that which is benefit you. Seek that which is of benefit to you. In other words, this is something which is an active process where we should always seek preventative means if that's possible. Then the second point here is use active therapy for preventative means is encouraged. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever eats 7 dates of Medina in the morning will not be harmed by witchcraft or poison. So this is clearly recorded in Sahih Bukhari on the Bab on Ajwa. And then finally, prevention. So this is another very important thing, that if you hear of a plague in a place, do not go there. And if it occurs where you are, do not leave such a place. This is another hadith. I'm sure you've had this hadith presented to you before, recorded in Sahih Bukhari. Here you have stringent conditions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if there is a plague there, if there is ta'un, then do not enter that region. And if you are in a place where there is ta'un, then do not leave that area. So these are certain stipulated conditions that are presented in the Sharia, which are clearly bound by the ahadith, by the prophetic tradition. Now, the other thing is some people argue the case and say, look, vaccines use the source that's causing the illness as a form of treatment. And this is something that we should be always suspect about. But let's get the fact right here. So we have ahadith, we have prophetic traditions, which clearly highlight that the source of the illness can be used as a therapy. We have this hadith in Bukhari, Abu Huraira narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if a housefly falls in drink of any of you, then he should dip it in the drink. For one of its wings has a disease and the other has the cure for the disease. So here we're using the source itself as a form of ailment. And we have many commentaries by some of the Shahari, the commentators of hadith, in particular Shah Waliyullah Dehlawi Rahimullah, who states in his Hujjatullah Baligha, he says this hadith shows that there is a God-given knowledge of the many diseases a fly potentially carries, as well as illustrates the Creator's wisdom in giving this venomous species some immunity. So in other words, you can use those sources as a form of healing. The other point to remember here is in the Sharia, we don't look at harms just solely from a secular physical perspective. We also recognize harms can be of a spiritual nature. So for us, we are even more stringent about accepting harms of different natures. So for us, physical harms are clearly something that we recognize. So if you take a medication and it's clearly physically harming you, causes liver damage, causes heart disease and various other things, and causes adverse effects, then that would be considered fall within the remit of physical harms. But we also have a sense of what we call spiritual harms, which is where we have issues of najas, something which is impure, and khabath. These khaba'ith, those things are considered as impure, they will harm us spiritually. So from the Sharia perspective, if vaccines or medications contain haram ingredients, then that would be considered by default not permissible, unless there is evidence to show its effectiveness and there are no other alternatives. And we will talk about these conditions. So this is a case, okay, where a vaccine contains something which is considered as haram. At the current record, we know the vaccines currently available, none of them contain any animal ingredients. None of them contain any ingredients that would be considered as haram. Now, this particular slide relates two particular processes. One's called istihala and the other is called istihla. Istihala is transformation. So transformation in the sense that if a product is transformed from one particular product, which is haram, to another product, which is halal, then that is an acceptable process and that final product will be considered as halal for you to consume. So let me give an example. So if, for example, alcohol, khamar, transformed to vinegar, then the vinegar would be considered as halal. Now, on the basis of that, you will see that some scholars agree and they say porcine gelatin would be considered as halal in such instances, because that is what we call tabdil mahiya. There's a change in the transformation significant enough to say that it is now halal. The other process is called istihlak. Okay, istihlak is where something is diluted to such a degree that now it's permissible for you to consume this. So for example, we have the fermentation process of yeast that occurs in bread, and we still have remnants of ethanol or alcohol that still remain in bread. Now that is such a dilute small amount, an insignificant amount, and that would be still considered as halal. And the same would arise when if alcohol was converted to vinegar, even in vinegar, the final product, you will still have a small percentage of alcohol in there. So that would be considered as halal for you to consume. So here we have these two processes that we sort of refer to. Now, if you look at it from that particular perspective, there are certain four conditions, and I'll just quickly outline those four conditions. I won't bother even going through the slides. The first condition is that there has to be at least some acknowledgement by medical science that this particular medication is effective. If there is evidence that this medication is effective, then on the basis of that, even if it contains haram ingredients, current vaccines don't even include haram ingredients. But let's say, even if they did contain haram ingredients, they would still be permissible because you're balancing harms. Okay, so they would be permissible if there is no other alternative. So on the basis of that, that condition will be met. There are three principles that we need to also look at, approach to fake news. One is, and these are very important because there's a lot of news out there. So I'm just going to reiterate, I probably won't get the time for anything further than that. So I'll quickly talk about these three principles. The first is you must seek advice from those who possess knowledge. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرٍ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of ذِكْر, Ahle Dhik, the people of knowledge, if you do not know. So if you're somebody who is not of the Ahle Dhik, then you are dependent on the Ahle Dhik. So if you're taking news and information from people who are not of the Ahle Dhik, then that is something that you will be held liable for, especially because of that, people are being harmed. So this is something very important to understand. The other thing is you need to verify the information. Ya yalazina amanu, in ja'akum fasiqun binaba'in. If somebody comes to you who is a fasik, a sinful person, and he informs you of any information, then verify it. You need to verify information before you send this off to other people. If you're not doing that and that causes harm to others, you are held liable for this from the Sharia perspective. And finally, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu taqullah wa kunu ma'as sadiqin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all those who believe, who fear Allah, then be with the truthful people. In other words, search for the track record of those individuals who are giving you this information and clarify that information, especially from the community who knows that individual. So there's a lot of viral videos going around with people giving emotive messages, and those individuals have no track record of their own. So inshallah, get those confirmed. And then finally, I'll finish off on this note. There are certain conditions. If there's any questions, I can relate some of the slides in those questions. But generally speaking, these are some of the qawaid, these are some of the principles that we use to weigh up the concept of harms. So here we have, for example, adhurur yuzal, we must eliminate harm. The other is adhurur ashaddu yuzala bi dhurur akhar. So another, a severe harm, a greater harm, must be eliminated and tolerated by a lesser harm. So in other words, even if these vaccines demonstrated that they were harmful, let's say there was a percentage of the population that was dying because of this. If the actual harm of COVID-19 is such that it is much greater and more significant than this particular harm, even then that vaccine would be considered as acceptable from the Sharia perspective. Now, one final point, and I'll leave it there, inshallah, is that we also have to understand that some fuqaha, some of the scholars of today, they say it's an obligation for you to take a vaccine, especially since it contains no haram ingredients. And the reason why that is because you are a potential source of harm to other people by spreading this illness to others. So on the basis of that, it becomes a right of that person to be protected from you, and it becomes an obligation upon you to actually protect yourself so that you are protecting that individual. So for that reason, certain fatawa are out there at the moment that say they give the sense of wujud, an obligation for you to take vaccines. But khair, you know, I'm not of that sort of opinion, but generally speaking, I would recommend it, and it's something that we should try to accept. Inshallah, I'll finish on that note. There is a couple of other slides, but we'll leave it there, inshallah, because I recognize I've run out of time, and we could discuss other things in the questions, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair.
Jazakallah, Dr. Rafaqat. So I'm going to pass it on to our next and final speaker. Is Noor Abad here? Would you like to? Yeah, perfect.
Assalamu alaikum to all the listeners. After the in-depth speakers before me, I don't think I can add much more, but may Allah bless them both for giving such an insightful and important message. However, I will try to add a different viewpoint from a community perspective. First of all, I think there's lots of misinformation out there, mainly driven by WhatsApp messages being shared without collaboration. And we look at the impact of coronavirus, it's had a massive impact on the UK, but also on the Muslim community. These have been amplified due to significant health inequalities, but also poverty. The poverty facing the Muslim community is an underlying reason for it being disproportionately being impacted by the pandemic. 46% of the Muslim community in the UK live in 10% of the most deprived local authorities in England. More than half of the British, Pakistani and British Bangladeshi diaspora children live in poverty. Underlying health conditions in the Muslim community like diabetes, high blood pressure, and obesity are amplifying this pandemic. There's also evidence that the lack of vitamin D is playing a massive factor and adding to the severity on the impact of the virus in the community. And so from my perspective, I think the exposure of the on the Muslim community being key workers is great, whether it's the doctors or the nurses working within the NHS, but also on the other spectrum of the community is you've got your taxi drivers and the bus drivers, and the way the Muslim household being multi-generational household, that's having a massive impact. So that's why we need to take the precaution, but also take this vaccine when it's offered. But just to add some of the statistics and, you know, examples from East Lancashire, where I'm based, over 50 burials have taken place in the cemetery in Blackburn in January alone this year. And just to put that into perspective, in 2019, we had 171 in the whole year. So in 1 month, we've had 50. And in 2019, in the whole year, we've had 171. And over half have been due to COVID-related fatalities. So it highlights the impact it's had in East Lancashire on the Muslim community. One masjid in Nelson in East Lancashire has lost all its has lost half of its committee members due to coronavirus, and they've been impacted at the different stages of the pandemic. So it realizes, you know, how much it is. That's why I think it's important that we take the vaccine when it's offered to us. And on a personal level, both my parents have been vaccinated, one with the Pfizer vaccine and the other with the Oxford AstraZeneca. And alhamdulillah, they've had no adverse effect. And two of my siblings who are on the front line with the NHS have also been vaccinated. So that's why I think it's important to encourage our community and obviously the wider community, as soon as the vaccine is offered to them, we do accept, because I think, like Shaykh has said, we have a duty to protect ourselves, but also the people that we come into contact with. Jazakallah khair.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that, Nordad. And thank you to all the speakers that we had today. And I think that that moves us on to the Q&A. And I know that some of the questions have been answered within the chat, but I have received, I think, up to four questions here, which I'm going to give to some of our speakers, if that's okay. So these questions are directed to Munna and Dr. Rafaqat. So the question number one, this is for you, Dr. Munna, if that's okay. So I'm going to read it out. Is it true that in the first week after the first dose of Pfizer vaccine, the immune system may be preoccupied by reacting to the vaccine, and therefore our immune system may be a bit more vulnerable in the face of infection? It seems many people are dying or getting COVID severely or getting severe side effects such as nervous convulsions or Bell's palsy within a day or two after having the Pfizer or Moderna vaccines in the USA. So that one's for you, Dr. Munna.
Yes, thank you very much. That's a really good question. Thank you. So when the vaccine first gets into your body, it will take you up to 3 weeks for you to mount an immune response. And so it's that length of time when if you'd been exposed to the virus before that you could become unwell with the virus, and it isn't anything to do with the vaccine at all. And there are other, of course, there's a general level of ill health in the population. People can still get diabetes, people can still get high blood pressures, people can still get Bell's palsy. So everything that's natural in the community will continue to happen during COVID, and it's not related to the vaccine that you had at all.
Sure. I have another question for you, Dr. Munna, and then I know that you want to share some of your, I think it's your last few slides, wasn't it?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so I'll give you time for that after you've answered this question, if that's okay. So question number two, what is your response to the rumours about vaccine having possibly negative effects on fertility in women?
So the vaccine is mimicking the virus itself, and it's mimicking just a button on a coat of a virus, or it's mimicking a portion of the virus itself in terms of its nucleic acids. So it's not related whatsoever to anything related with fertility. There's nothing related with hormones. It's very, very specific to the virus, and that's what it is. I think women of childbearing age should actually go for the vaccine, and they can continue to plan their pregnancies afterwards in the usual way.
Thank you, Dr. Munna. Would you like to share the last couple of slides that you wanted to share, if you want to go ahead with that.
So thank you very much. So actually, I just wanted to explain why we were going east, and you'll see there's an elephant at the bottom of the slide. So east throughout my presentation was referring to the way we can talk about COVID and the way we can talk about the vaccines. We have to give out some easy messages that we know already quite a lot about the virus and the vaccines. They're safe and they are free. It's an attractive message that we care so much about our loved ones, and the vaccine is just an extra layer of protection. It's social, it matters to us, our lives matter. So many of our elders and frontline workers have now had the vaccine. Others are queuing up for the turn, and we are too. So you're a trusted person in your community. Speak to your loved ones and make sure that you're promoting the vaccine. And it's really timely. It's relevant to us now. We're lucky to live in a country with early access to the vaccine, so don't delay. And this means that people can go back to work, education, and our businesses can pick up much faster. So what's it to do with elephants? I think it's how do you eat an elephant? And the answer is just one bite at a time. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Munna. So on to question number three, and I think this one's for Shaykh Rafaqat. So the question is, some people contracted COVID and their body fought the virus quite well. So if our body can fight the virus, if you have no underlying health issues, do we still need to take the vaccination?
Okay, yeah, this is a question that sometimes is raised, and it's interesting how certain scholars have even mentioned this in the sense that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created insan in a way, man in a way that we should be able to fight off infections just generally. There's a, you know, a human specific immune response that we have. The response to that is, then you need to go back into the fiqh literature and you will see that you'll have many, many chapters of Kitab al-Tib and about, chapters related to Dadawi seeking treatment, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked by the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, where they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, should we seek treatment? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tadawo, seek treatment, seek therapy. And in fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sought treatment himself. So on the on that particular perspective, that is already indicating that there are many conditions out there where it becomes a role and a duty for a community, at least for people within the community, to go out there and search for forms of treatment as cure or to relieve symptoms. So from that particular perspective, to sort of suggest that, hang on, Allah has created us in a such a way that our body can deal with all this, is not what the Islam is really stating. Rather, what Islam is saying is there are certain things that Allah has created in the body where we can fight certain forms of infection. But generally speaking, there will be occasions where we will be tested to that degree where we cannot. So there are clearly vulnerable people within our communities, such as the elderly, those who have comorbidities, diabetes, and many other sort of underlying conditions, who are vulnerable, who can't. So to protect them, then it becomes an obligation to seek treatment. And the only treatment that we have today, unfortunately for COVID-19, is vaccines. There is nothing else out there which is of that level of effectiveness. And vaccines have an effectiveness of approximating 95% or even higher. So from that perspective, it reaches well beyond what we consider as ghalabat al-dhan, which is in essence referring to the level of certainty that we require even to accept them, even if they contain haram ingredients. So on that perspective, that sort of response is something that can very easily be argued away.
Thank you, Dr. Rafaqat. So I have question four, and this can be directed to Dr. Munna or yourself. So it's quite a long one. There are many, many generally helpful, effective treatments at home and on prescription that seem safer than the vaccines. These are antivirals, antibacterial, and immune system nourishing. Many of these are vitamin and mineral supplements, such as high doses of vitamin D3 plus K2, vitamin C, zinc, magnesium, etc. Also, they include many safe foods, spices, and herbs. Prescription medicines found useful include hydroxychloroquine, which is at least partly derived from Nigella sativa, so black seeds, ivermectin, azithromycin, remdesivir, the best of which seem to be ivermectin. It seemed that between these, most people could avoid severe symptoms. These treatments should be used widely as they can help even those with weak immune systems who cannot take the vaccine without problems, either not generating antibodies or reacting badly. We should prefer the treatments with greater benefits and less harms. It seems vaccines were pushed and safer, cheaper treatments suppressed. Why is this? So this is for, sorry if the clarity of the question wasn't the best. And this is for Dr. Munna or Dr. Rafaqat, both of you.
I'll come in, and I'm sorry, the video, I'm having some technical problems here, so I'm only able to talk without coming on video. So it's really a good question, because you're pointing out the importance of health and well-being, general health and well-being, and promoting sort of eating healthily, but also we know physical activity is a miracle drug. If it were a medicine, we'd all be queuing up for physical activity. So that's the importance of general health, but it doesn't protect you specifically against something like the coronavirus, which you don't have immunity for. None of us have immunity to it. And so that's why the vaccine is really good idea, because it protects you specifically against this particular coronavirus. General health and well-being protects you generally, but it doesn't stop you becoming unwell from all of the other sort of illnesses. It doesn't stop you getting diabetes and so on. So you have to look after your general health, and you also have to take the specific precautions. Thank you.
Can I answer that question as well? Okay, so now you're talking about certain drugs. Okay, vitamin D, and I know there is some evidence to suggest that those people who have low vitamin D, and that the evidence is suggesting those people have low vitamin D or vitamin D deficient, if you give them vitamin D supplements, and that would be protective for them, not the fact that it will cure them. So I think some of these misunderstandings arise. You mentioned a couple of drugs there, which we, as in general practice, I'm a GP as well. So in general practice, we are considered as disease modifying drugs, like hydroxychloroquine. And these are drugs that require you to monitor people's blood on a regular basis. And they are clearly prescribed, and those kind of patients are followed up because of the possible harmful side effects of these drugs. So we're willing to take these drugs by the same drug companies, but we're not willing to take vaccines which have a much more safer profile. Doesn't make any sense to me, honestly. So we need to be very real about this. The reality is there are people dying out there, especially the vulnerable, and we are playing at these alternate cards which don't make any sense. We're looking at things that are presented in tablet form, which are even more toxic than you can think of as drugs. They have more adverse effects, but we're accepting them from the very same drug companies that we're questioning with vaccines. But yet, you know, we're trying to make sense of that. So let's be real about this. Let's get our facts right. Let's understand the situation. Let's understand the depth of the seriousness of what COVID-19 is doing to us. This is a world pandemic. Islam states that when we have a hajjatul am, something which is considered as not even a necessity, but just a need, right? Which is predominant and is in a public environment. So in other words, it's all over in the public. Tanazzulu manzalat al-dhurura. It comes to the level of dhurura. Dhurura is that basically when you have the state of dhurura, an issue in Islam which is prohibited becomes halal when you are in the state of dhurura. So another hajat al-am, haja, a need which affects a whole community, is that stringent that Islam would even allow those things that are being haram to be permitted in that situation. Now, vaccines, COVID vaccines that are currently out there, the Pfizer, the AstraZeneca, and so forth, these vaccines are halal. They don't even contain haram ingredients. So what's the issue? There's no serious evidence out there. We've had so many people vaccinated. Millions of people have been vaccinated. Now, and the level of stringency and the level of speculation that has been drawn to the vaccines at the moment is unprecedented. The level of search and research. And so if we have any issue of harm from these vaccines, then you be sure that it will be out there in the media, you know, without a doubt. If there's any benefit in that, then nobody's going to spread that news around. The reality is that this is just human behavior. That's the way we behave. And we need to get away from these speculations. They have no basis in Islam. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we got what we call the umum of the evidence, which is telling us with a dominant probability that these vaccines are safe. That's enough. That's all we need to know in the Sharia, and they are halal. That's even better. That's a blessing in itself. Let's stick to the facts. Let's see what our deen tells us, and it's telling us very clearly that such vaccines are permissible. Let's not talk about alternatives which are clearly far effective, less effective than using vaccines today. We need to provide and reach a state of herd immunity. So that means that at least 60-70% of our community needs to be vaccinated for us to eliminate this COVID sort of disaster that we're undergoing at the moment, which means that some of us who are not in the risk group would have to take that vaccine to protect those who are at risk. So from that perspective, let's see it from that perspective. Do your deed for your community and take your vaccine. And we're even getting cases where people, alhamdulillah, the take-up's improving, but we're getting cases where the younger generation, these are people, because I know this audience is young, the younger generation are convincing or consider themselves of protecting their elders by saying that these vaccines are harmful, don't take them. Subhanallah, are you going to hold some liability if something happens to your elder? Are you going to take that liability on your head? So, you know, be very careful what kind of information you're relating to the vulnerable people around you. Yeah, get your facts right and go according to what the consensus is saying on this issue. And you have now a number of fatawa out there that's saying it's permissible for you to take vaccines. So what's the problem? What's holding you back?
Absolutely. Thank you for that, Dr. Rafaqat. That's quite a powerful message. I just want to let the audience know that we're now finishing at 9:05. So we have 3 minutes to answer the remaining questions. So if you can try and keep them as succinct as possible. So question number 5. I know that a lot of people in our community are confused about the vaccine allegedly containing cells from aborted fetus. Please, can you give some clarity on this matter?
Okay, so this issue about aborted fetus is over-sensationalizing something which clearly doesn't even fall within the remit or something that would be considered as haram. The first thing is, it doesn't really matter whether it's aborted or not aborted. At the end of the day, it's human part. So a cell or that is basically used as a medium for the process of producing a vaccine is the main issue here. Whether it's aborted or not, that's not something that is liable. It's not a liability that we carry. We are not liable for that. That's an act for the person who committed that act, whether that was done in a halal way or a haram way. That's a separate issue. It doesn't relate to this. The second thing is that when it comes to using human body parts as a form of medication, there is a question, there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars related to that issue. But the thing is that when I talked about the two processes, I talked about one, the concept of what we call istihala, and the second I talked about istihlak. Istihlak refers to, is there or are there any remnants of that product in the final product that you're using? And the answer to that is, there are no fetal cells. There are no fetal products in the final vaccine that you're using at the present moment in time. It's free from this. It clearly is haram from that particular perspective as well.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rafaqat. And the final question is for Dr. Munna. And this individual has said, Salam again, Dr. Munna. Do individuals have a choice in terms of which vaccination to take? Can you please talk a bit more about the way the different vaccinations are being rolled out? I know we're short on time, so if you can make this answer as quick as possible.
So the three vaccines are being rolled out, Pfizer, Oxford, AstraZeneca, and Moderna, and there are two more that will be rolled out as well. There isn't a single supply chain that can cover the whole world. So the more manufacturers, the more vaccines that come out, then the more the chances are that everyone will get covered who needs to be protected. And so you should just take whichever vaccine arrives at your door, and you're invited to any one of those is safe and is effective.
Okay, great. Thank you. And I'd like to conclude by thanking our speakers and taking the time out to deliver this lecture. So thank you all very much. I hope you learned something productive today, and I wish you a good week ahead. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.